Pretty good. How about yourself, sir?
Not too bad. Thank you as always for dropping in.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
So or it's this week was more story building for both shows on the road to WrestleMania, which is okay. There's really protecting a lot of the wrestlers, I feel like, on the way there, as far as not really having them wrestle or do anything, because you don't want to have any more people hurt than what already is. So it makes sense. Thank you, sir, for the host.
Problem.
You're the hostess with the mostest. So yeah, we're gonna start off with SmackDown again this week, like we did last week, and there we go. I told you the dashboard would do that.
I kind of thought that I heard it, but I wasn't sure.
So anyway, so SmackDown this week we had four matches again. I think last week we had what, three?
Well, I actually have the notebook here, so I can tell you in just a second.
Well, the running trend with SmackDown is it either has three or four matches.
Yep, there was three last week.
Okay. So just to run through them really quick, because not really much going on in terms of the matches. First match, I think, was Becky Lynch and Natalya. And long story short, I don't remember who won. I just know at the end, Carmella comes out and pretty much inserts herself into the women's match that's going to be at WrestleMania for the SmackDown title, which still haven't heard if it's going to be a Battle Royal, if it's going to be a Gauntlet. We don't know. They're kind of running that too. Like, that's the whole thing. They just were talking about it, the announcers were, and I kind of get the feeling that they don't even know.
Yeah, that's definitely the way it seems.
Like, it's not even planned. It's just like, this is happening. We're going to have all the women in the roster wrestle in this match, and you guys
Yeah.
will love it.
Enjoy.
And they're still doing the whole, like, any available women or woman that could. Basically, you leave it open for Naomi, which is fine. It makes sense.
Becky Lynch actually won that match.
That's
It was
right.
an okay match. I
Yeah.
mean,
Well, the finish was cool because she got Natalya in the corner and Becky was up on the top rope, I think, and like did a roll off the top rope into the disarmor. So that was kind of cool. So then the next match of the night was Mickie James and Alexa Bliss. And Mickie James won that with a Mick kick.
yep.
Not much else to say there.
It was kind of a, it was one of those matches where I just kind of tuned out. It wasn't spectacular, and there wasn't like a whole lot to talk about.
But you know what was better, what was good about this match?
What's that?
That it was not the next match, which was Mojo Rawley versus Dolph Ziggler. Ziggler.
Ziggler, yes. You gotta say it just like JBL or you're not saying it right. Actually, I felt more invested in Dolph Ziggler as a heel, as a heel here than what I have the entire time he was doing his Kalisto and Apollo Crews bullcrap.
Yeah, I still can't get behind any of it at all,
Oh, I
honestly.
know. And then on top of that, you of course have Mojo, who's trying his best.
I will give Mojo credit for the fact that he's not acting like himself as much as far as like running around screaming and going on, and
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Right.
So it makes him somewhat more bearable. I think both of these guys are going to be the Andre the match we don't care about at WrestleMania. I don't think, well, they announced, spoiler, I guess, what we're going to talk about anyway, but they announced the Big Show is also going to be in that match for Raw. And that's the only three people that they even mentioned so far. And we're what, like basically 15 days away, 16, 17 days away?
Yeah, how many people are typically in that?
I don't remember. I don't remember. I'm not sure.
Oh well.
Yeah, oh well. Again, the Andre, the match we don't care about, so. And then the next match, I guess what would be the main event, maybe, of the night? I don't know if you could call it main event. was the Usos versus American Alpha. Yay, we love it. Don't you?
No.
You don't love it?
I think I sent you a text message about this. In particular, this was the section of the match. Like, if this was the main event, but they constantly interrupted it.
Oh yeah.
Not as in like they it like it felt unimportant. Not only did it feel unimportant because I could care less for either one of the tag teams that were in it, but it also felt unimportant because of how they just kind of, we don't really care about this section of the show. We're going to update you on some other stuff that we're going to talk about in a second.
The overarching story of the night.
Yes.
Side note real quick before we get into everything else. I thought one of the biggest, most positive things of the night for me, I guess we should finish talking about this match. We'll get to that more in a second because this is more important to me, is the fact that, phone's dying, JBL and Tom Phillips was the only announcers, and it was...
I had that written in all caps, and he even says in the show, I hope this is permanent.
It was about 100,000 times better with only two people, and JBL didn't even really screw up that much. He was perfectly fine. I like Tom Phillips a lot anyway, so that was fine. Man, and it made such a difference.
Oh, yes, it did. And the fact that you didn't have to like wait and count how many times Mamma Mia was screamed at the top of their lungs.
Mamma Mia! Yeah, I know.
Yeah. I actually felt like this was the best, as far as the announcing goes, the best week in forever.
Yep. And I think that, what was I going to say? Basically, with those two being there, so I normally zone out like each week when it comes to the announcing for the most part, because it's always so bad and they have bad puns and they are like tripping over one another, like reading off their paper, that their script that they have. But I felt like with just the two, with less human error, it was just a lot better. And they really need to go back to just having two people versus three and four.
I agree. Well, like they used to have, Michael Cole used to be an interviewer backstage. And right. Then they, for whatever reason, were like, oh, let's change that up completely. And
I think it would be really cool to have Renee Young as an announcer, because I don't think they've actually had a female announcer before, or not that I can think of. But I think
I don't think they have either. It would make a lot of sense to have her, and like if they're going to continue this route, get Otunga out of there, get Ronaldo out of there, and have like JBL, Tom Phillips, and Renee Young.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I feel like that could do wonders.
Oh, and we forgot to mention earlier when Carmella was in. Of course, we had to see Ellsworth yet again,
doing his.
Yeah. Yeah, well, he only got like 3 seconds of airtime, so that was nice.
That was more than enough.
With the Usos match, because it's so important, the Usos won. I guess that makes them the new number one contender against American Alpha. Not that anybody cares.
Yeah, like, no.
I'm purposely, like, forgetting this and going back to it, just in case you're curious, because I don't care. Shows how much invested.
It doesn't. You don't care. You're not invested. I'm not invested. But the show must go on.
Yes, the show must go on. We got to mention that, like dog ear it there. Like, okay, that happened.
Yeah.
So since I just beat through all that real fast, I'll let you take over from here as far as whichever one you want to cover next. It doesn't matter.
Well, actually, okay, well, I'll let you start the one that I don't then. I'm going to go with this. Okay, so the night starts with Daniel Bryan on the phone, and he's talking about how Miz promises the biggest Miz TV thing, his stupid talk show that every wrestler seems to have nowadays. And he promises like the biggest ever like people to ever be on the show or whatever, and then he gets down there and in typical Miz fashion, it's him and Maryse. And he like slams Cena the whole time. And honestly, I like John Cena. I'm not, how do I put this? I like John Cena a lot, but I'm not afraid to point out when he does like really stupid stuff. And I felt like Miz was pretty on with everything that he said.
On point.
Which was pretty good, actually. And then I wrote down here that Maryse is basically the female Tommy Wiseau. And they just give her like the stupidest lines to say, and she's not like, she's not very, like, she's okay on the mic, but she's not very good.
She's not good with the fact that she doesn't really get to talk or do anything ever.
Right. And she's just kind of there.
And they're giving her bucket of cheese to talk about, so...
Yeah.
It's not very good.
In particular, on the Miz TV segment, they have her and him talking about something, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he's basically like, okay, so what would you... tell us the story about what happened. And she was like, well, and she starts to talk, and then he's like, got to lead her through it the entire time. And I mean, kudos to him for being able to do that or whatever, but it just feels really forced. I don't really like it. But at this point, Cena runs down with Nikki Bella, and Miz and Maryse run out. And Nikki Bella, like, rips her stupid shirt off and rips her stupid hat off her head and is like, look at me, I'm ready to fight. And so we're going to get, it wasn't officially announced until that night, but Daniel Bryan comes out and he basically makes a match because he is tired of Miz impersonating him poorly.
And it makes you want to punch you in the face.
Right. He's made the match Cena and Nikki versus Maryse and Miz at WrestleMania, which I'm pretty sure everybody can see a mile away where this is going.
Yep.
At WrestleMania, who's going to win? And
sorry, kids.
Yeah.
Yep.
It was pretty poopy.
Yeah, I mean, it was an okay segment. Like, The Miz is always good anytime he's talking, but I know what you mean with Maryse. Anybody else I'd probably blame, but just the fact that she never gets to talk or say or do anything, I'm not going to hound her about it either, you know?
It's a pass. Like, it's different for somebody who is Brock Lesnar. And you give him the mic, and he's just like, I punch stuff.
Yeah.
And you're like, okay, well, you get paid hundreds of thousands of dollars to come out and go like this and then go down and punch stuff.
And smile.
Yeah.
I agree. Let's see. So another promo that we had last night was Randy Orton comes out to address Bray Wyatt. And basically he does his spiel again of, hey, if you can't beat him, join him. And then when it's time, screw him.
Yep.
And Bray Wyatt appears on the screen talking his oblivious gibberish.
About Sister Abigail and the kingdom.
Yep, and you thought that you burned her, and but the only thing you really did was release her, and now she is free, and I've taken over her power, and now... Basically declaring himself as a god.
I will say that I feel like as far as the spookiness goes, he is the Undertaker right now.
Mm-hmm.
or at least the Undertaker of today.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like it works really well. And that promo, like, I knew where I didn't know where it was going, but as soon as he shows up on the screen, I'm like, oh, good, we didn't get this last week.
Yeah. Well, and he's in what we are led to believe was the cabin, his house. I wish they wouldn't call it his house because it's not furnished. It's just something that's bugging me.
No, it had a rocking chair.
Stop it. So anyway, but he's in. There's smoke everywhere still, where the palace apparently is still burning, and he takes some ashes, apparently of Sister Abigail. I don't know. I guess that's kind of where they want you to believe, and rubs it all over his face, and that's when he starts talking about becoming a god. And I actually really enjoyed that whole thing with him. I thought it was pretty cool because not only the whole he's Undertaker now, but he's just nobody else does this stuff.
Right. And that's exactly what I mean, really. Like, with him being the Undertaker now,
right,
is not even the Undertaker really does this stuff anymore. Like, at WrestleMania, some druids carry him down or whatever, but
puts on some good eyeliner, does a Maybelline commercial.
Yeah.
So the big overarching thing of the night was AJ being pissed off that he's not in WrestleMania.
Yep.
And the first thing he does when at the beginning of the night, Daniel Bryan's on the phone, which is what you were talking about earlier. Whoever he was talking to. And AJ comes in and interrupts and basically is like, "Where's Shane at? This is bullcrap. I'm the best.
I'm on the phone."
Yeah, I'm on the phone. Even though it looked like there was some kind of cooking recipe on his background, but I could be wrong. But yeah, so AJ's going on saying that he needs to be in WrestleMania and this crap that he's not, and he's done everything, and he's beat everybody that he needed to beat, and he still got screwed.
Yep.
So then he's like, "I'm going to go out in the ring and tell everybody what's going on, and I don't care." So his music hits. He's not in any get-up. He doesn't come out, and he just walks straight through the ring, doesn't give a shit, grabs a mic, starts spilling his guts, and basically is like, "I'm going to talk to Shane. We're going to have a one-on-one. This is crap." And he's like, "Yeah, I lost to John Cena at Royal Rumble. I face it. I understand. Whatever. It doesn't matter."
"But I didn't get my title rematch."
"But I didn't get my title rematch, and I should have got my title rematch." And he was, I forget the other instance, but he was basically saying there was twice that he should have got a rematch, but I think it's because Bray Wyatt pinned John Cena, so he's saying he didn't get a rematch on his own.
Yeah, that's what it was.
Malik Monk, hey, how's it going? You have YouTube accounts? Yes, if you go to YouTube and search Final Save Point, you go to that channel, you can look at our past videos. So yeah, so then AJ, basically at that point, drops the mic, goes backstage, and you just keep seeing him, like, looking for Shane McMahon throughout the night.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see, just make sure I don't miss anything. Yep, so basically the next thing that happened, like, midways or, like, the last little bit of the match or the night was Renee Young is interviewing him, and she's like, "Hey, why are you so pissed off at Shane? What's going on?" "Ever BCHS News YouTube?" "I have not." "It's a school YouTube channel."
That's pretty cool.
But so he's like, "Well, I'm going to show you what I'm going to do," because then the garage door opens, because before that there's like three segments, short clips where he's back there launching or just watching the back door. Finally it comes up and he's like crouches down behind a car for whatever reason. Renee Young didn't say, "Hey Shane, watch out."
Yeah. Oh, well, he said something mean to me one time, so he's gonna get what's coming to him, right?
Yeah. So AJ then proceeds to attack Shane as soon as he gets out of his car, throws him into a door, throws him into another door, beats the crap out of him, throws him through a car window where I don't know if he bladed or if he just somehow cut his head.
I don't think it was real. I think it was like some after effect.
Yeah, I'm not sure. That's kind of a weird spot to Blade, though. But so, you know, he beats the crap out of him. Then everybody comes in to try to break it up. And once he does, he like walks away for a minute, comes back and just kicks him one more time in the chest for good measure.
Mm-hmm.
And, good.
The thing that I really appreciated about this is out of nowhere, I haven't seen him in a while, but I haven't really been paying attention to see if he's there. Finley.
Was he? I didn't even see him.
Yeah, he was, I thought I heard him before I saw him. And the guy who runs up and is like, Shane, are you okay? It was him.
Oh, okay.
And he like sits there with him the whole time.
Very nice.
Yep.
So, you know, everybody's trying to persuade Shane at this point to see, get medical attention. And Shane's like, nah, I'll be fine. Like, walks off. And so then throughout the night, they keep updating you on Shane, there's a segment where AJ's in the back with the Usos, and I don't remember the other guy, but they're basically like, man, why you gotta do that? You're gonna get yourself fired. And AJ's like, I don't care. I could care less. So then
it was the dude that walks around with the cane now.
Oh, Curt Hawkins.
Yeah.
So he goes out, Daniel Bryan's out there with four suited up guys, and basically was like, hey, you're fired. I can't believe that you did that. And these suited up policemen, even though they're just probably some up and coming training wrestlers, escorted AJ out of the building. Wrestling talk, woo! Indeed.
Deedy leedy, indeed. The thing that I thought was funniest about this was AJ. I wrote AJ fired, lol. Like,
yeah, because Daniel's like, I don't care how much you mean to the company or what you've done, you're fired. It's like,
yeah,
come on, man.
Go ahead, sorry.
Well, I was just going to say he's like pretty much carried that brand on his back since it happened.
Exactly.
He's not going anywhere. So then, of course, we keep getting updates all through the night about Shane. You keep seeing him backstage, which I think I saw Arn Anderson back there, too. I could be wrong, but it looked like
him. Oh, yeah, like when Shane was walking out to go out the curtain or whatever.
Yep. So then he goes out, and he just... Well, for me, I had recorded it, and it cut it off here, and I was really mad. But it cut it off as soon as Shane walks out to get in front of the crowd. And so I had to go on YouTube and look. He wants to subscribe to Beast right now. I have 10 minutes left. Dude, what is this even about? Come on, man. Anyway, so he basically says, you know what? AJ doesn't have a opponent at WrestleMania. Well, he does now. And of course, everybody's like, yay! But then everybody else is kind of like, oh, we didn't really want this to happen. I'm still intrigued by the whole thing, honestly. So I'm kind of looking forward to it in my own way.
I will say, I thought that it was already pretty set in stone that it was going to happen. But I was kind of surprised that they waited until the end of the show. But I guess it kind of makes sense. It was a good opener and a good closer. Like, it was the overarching thing the whole time. And then also, I felt like... what was it? I like how the announcers at one point were like on... Well, JBL especially was like, AJ's right. He blah, 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 blah. He deserves this. And then AJ goes and does that. And he's like, that was the most disgraceful thing I've ever seen.
I can't even believe for somebody like AJ that he would do this right now. Like, I like when he's trying to get serious, like he starts talking like really quiet.
Yeah. And the best part about it all is, in reality, is the fact that, not really the best part. I guess it's kind of the worst part. I wish that we had announcers that, like, when that stuff happened, Like, okay, so I seem to remember, like, JR back in the day, like, when Stone Cold would get in the ring and, like, beat the crap out of Vince, that JR would be like, yeah, give it to him or whatever, you know? But, like, you don't... We went from 10... Well, I guess it's not been 10. 20 years ago, you know, 20 years ago, we went... We had Stone Cold doing all that stuff, and then we had... today, where there is no, like, you can't beat your boss up, don't do it, you'll get in trouble.
Yeah. But, that's a different day, a different era, though, right?
I guess, but it's AJ. AJ's just as gold as Stone Cold.
Nice rhyme. So, what would you rate the show as a whole?
I don't know. It just wasn't very good. Like, the promos were good.
I think it, like we kind of said at the beginning, like, this did a really good job of, like, building into WrestleMania as far as all the stories that mattered. But, like, the matches, like, if you tune in every week to actually watch matches and stuff...
You're screwed.
Yeah, it was a joke.
I don't know. I kind of... Let me... Hold on. Give me just a second. I felt like matches last week were better than this week.
Well, yeah, I mean, you had AJ in a match, so.
Yeah, I guess that's true. And we did have a tag team match with Becky Lynch and all that. Nah, that's a lie. There was better matches this week because I just saw Cena versus Ellsworth. Yeah, I would say, I think last week I gave it, like, we gave it, like, pretty low. I think maybe a 6.5.
That's what I was thinking, a 6. Just, the way I'm looking at it anymore, like, 6 is just average.
Yeah.
And I think it was just an average show. Like, if you didn't watch the show, you're not really missing a whole lot, because even with the things that did happen that moved the story along to WrestleMania, like, we already kind of knew it was going to go on and happen anyway.
Well, I mean, if you don't watch every week and you don't, like, pay attention to anything, like, coming in from the outside, you might not know.
Right.
But if you watched last week, you could kind of tell where the AJ stuff was going. Yeah, I mean, it's just one of those things where if you miss a week, you're not missing much. And I think it's kind of sad to say that, because they're always like, well, it's the road to WrestleMania. And I'm like, I have never been more disappointed with the lead up to a pay-per-view in my life. And it started with Fastlane.
Yeah. I think they did have a little thing with Baron Corbin again this week, too.
I didn't see that, but...
Yeah, it was just him backstage, really. Not much going on with it, but...
Hanging out in his boiler room.
Well, no, actually, it went back to him, and he's just standing next to the forklift, like, looking at it. And then one of the people that interviewed come up to him and interrupted him. He looked like, why are you disturbing me right now? I'm just looking at this forklift.
Oh, goodness. I honestly was pretty checked out of the entire show, except for, like, the really high points.
Well, I mean, if you look at it, American Alpha lost, who is champions, and Alexa Bliss lost, who is a champion.
Yep.
So they're doing that whole thing again. And Dean Ambrose, I don't think he's ever defended his Intercontinental belt since he's got it.
That'll be at Mania, for sure.
But, I mean, still, he's had it...
Oh, yeah, for a while. And he's not done anything with it.
Since, what, the beginning of the year, at least.
Oh, yeah, because he had it when he went into Elimination Chamber.
And Royal Rumble.
Yeah, because he went into the Rumble as...
And he has yet to defend it. That's the thing that always bugged me about SmackDown, though. Like, all their anybody with a belt, they never hardly have them in anything, and they don't really defend their belts. Like, even Bray Wyatt, since he's got it, he's only been in one match, which I know they're protecting him going into WrestleMania, but still, like, he hasn't really done anything since he became a champion.
I agree. It is pretty dumb.
So, moving on to Raw.
Yep.
This week we had opened up again with Brock Lesnar and Paul Heyman. I'll let you rant about this. Go ahead.
I'm sick of Brock Lesnar. I mean, I understand why he's there. It doesn't help when they replay the package for the show from last week at the beginning of the episode and then hammer it into your face. And then freaking Paul Heyman, like, Paul Heyman's great, don't get me wrong. Brock Lesnar's a good wrestler, don't get me wrong. But I'm sick of this whole... I'm sick of him coming out and standing there in the ring and smiling the whole time. And then Paul Heyman being there with him. And Paul Heyman, like, constantly yelling about Goldberg and Goldberg going down and... Lemon Merchant. Welcome in, sir. Came in at the wrong time. Psh.
You're fine. But go ahead.
But yeah, so it was pretty terrible. Not a good opener.
I mean,
it was Paul Heyman, so it was good, but it was.
I mean, it's fine. People get pumped about it, but I still just get... Well, actually, I think Brock Lesnar's got more chance this week than he has in a while, honestly.
Yeah.
And I think because people are getting kind of salty about the whole Goldberg having the belt in, like, 20 seconds thing.
Well, they should prepare for the main event of WrestleMania where Brock Lesnar takes the belt from him in 10 seconds.
Hopefully in 10 minutes, but...
That's not going to be 10 minutes. It's going to be the capstone of a great night.
Well, anyway, real quick, let me just say we're not even going to get on that right now.
Okay.
But the thing with the whole Brock Lesnar and Paul Heyman thing is still getting on my nerves, and I'm going to continue to complain about it because it's never going to change, so that's just what I'm going to do. I just want Brock Lesnar to say something. Mm-hmm. He has still yet to say anything, so pretty stupid. I mean, it's not going to hurt to have him say something.
I think the last time he said something was at... right before Survivor Series, and they had that interview with him and Paul Heyman, and they were sitting backstage.
Yeah.
It was kind of like the interview they did like 2 or 3 weeks ago, but he didn't pull his chair up and sit in front of the camera with Brock or with Paul Heyman talking behind his head.
Right.
Yeah, that bugs the hell out of me too, because it's like somebody who could probably do pretty well on the mic and doesn't get any lines probably gets paid less. And he shows up like once or twice a month, and suddenly he's like, "Oh well, I need a big paycheck because
I'm Brock Lesnar. I'm a big draw. Lesnar.
I was here like 10 or 15 years ago and left to play football, and then left to go fight in MMA, and then, oops,
I'm retired. I want back.
Yeah,
accept me. Yeah, but yeah, I kind of zoned out during this whole thing though." Because it's just the same spiel with this over and over again. Brock Lesnar down Goldberg, like, yay.
Yeah, and this is actually the only mention of this whole thing for the rest of the night. As far as I know, like the Hulu version didn't have anything else about it.
So. I think that was it. I don't remember anything else.
Well, good. I don't need to remember it.
I don't know what the next, like, what the first match was. I don't remember, but the first match I have wrote down was Sasha versus Dana Brooks.
That's the only thing that I have. There was 5 matches on Raw this week, by the way.
And, of course, your fan favorite, Dana Brooks, showed up again, so that's good for you.
Yep. She is so super-duper green, and... Again, it's one of those instances where they don't give some, like, they don't give you any, they don't give her anything to do. She's just there. You and your Hulu version. I will be getting the live version here soon. Hopefully. I just gotta plug the box in upstairs and then we're good.
Well, the thing with Dana Brooks that you're talking about, she's green. Mm-hmm. As you can tell by her timing in the match, which I don't really talk about anymore like I used to, but just some of the stuff, like, as she was going to set up her transition for Sasha to do stuff, she was just, like, standing there, like, way too early or way too late. but she just doesn't get enough in-ring time.
Yeah, and I mean, that's, I feel like they should ship her back to NXT, kinda. Because we also saw the split tonight after the match.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like we saw that sometime before, or something happened with them, maybe. I don't know. But, well, Sasha won the match in a heelish way again by pulling the tights.
No, she didn't pull the tights. It was close, but she didn't.
She pulled the tights.
She might as well have pulled the tights.
Yeah. Then Charlotte comes in and just starts yelling at Dana Brooke, basically saying, you're a piece of trash and you're a disgrace. Get out of here. Spoilers! Wait, that's what this show is all about. I should just call it WWE Spoiler Alert.
Yep.
Also, she just comes to basically, she's a piece of trash. Dana starts getting mad and just starts beating the crap out of Charlotte. And everybody in the audience, to my surprise, started chanting for Dana.
Yeah, I know. Like, okay.
Where does this go? Is she a face now? Is this what happened?
It's funny. You know, we were talking, I think you, I, and Lemon Merchant, we were all talking at Fastlane about, or on the Fastlane show, about how Sasha gets moved to heel, who moves over to face.
Somebody needs to, yeah. But Dana, so, of all people, like...
We get two greenos as the... As the face is on Raw now, so that's good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you have all like the experienced vets over on the heel side. Should be good.
Yeah.
So yeah, really, really nothing else to cover there. I mean, the women's division is just a fiasco right now on Raw and SmackDown. Just like the tag team division is a mess on both now. So next thing, we had a 205 Live match. Did you see that?
I didn't. Nope.
Okay. I literally just have started to watch, but then I just fast-forwarded through it. But it was Brian Kendrick and Tony Nese against Akira Tozawa, and I don't remember the other guy because I fast-forwarded it.
I see.
Yeah, it was not. Where's Jack Gallagher at? Since Fastlane, unless he got hurt.
He's recovering from those headbutts.
He's just getting his ass beat.
So that makes it 6 matches on Raw.
Yep. By the way, I'm down for some Jackbox after. Very nice. I was thinking that we'll get into some Jackbox after this, so should be fun times. I like Tozawa, but I hate his thing.
It's the same as that like Roman Reigns thing where he goes and gets in the corner when he's getting ready to do his spear and he goes
I kind of like it, honestly. It's like the one thing he does that I like. Oh, no mustache, gentlemen. Yeah, sorry.
Unfortunately.
So anyway, the next match I have wrote down was Samoa Joe and Kevin Owens against Chris Jericho and Sami Zayn.
The match made in heaven.
Yeah. Well,
with Kevin Owens and Joe.
Yep. It's a pretty good match. Probably the best match of the night for sure. Mm. It is a stupid gimmick. Still better than Roman.
Agreed.
It was a DQ finish. They pretty much... Well, hang on. I gotta say this real quick. The gentleman thing, I don't think it's so much of a stupid gimmick, honestly. I think it's kind of nice. It's something that's so simple that it's a good gimmick. Because
you're talking about Jack Gallagher?
Yeah, because I think he plays the part extremely well. And some of the other gimmicks they have... It's pretty good. I.e. see Kurt Hawkins. See Baron Corbin. Anyway, we'll stop there. No rants. No rants. Okay, so anyway. So this match ended in DQ. It was a good match. Basically what happened was... Well, they basically just was beating the crap out of them and didn't stop, wasn't it? And that what happened?
Yeah, they told Kevin to go back and he was just like, okay. And then he started kicking him again. It was Jericho. in particular.
Yeah.
I think.
Well, because he was getting ready to get him in the Walls of Jericho, and then that's when Samoa Joe came in.
That's right.
And they just kept stomping him, and they wouldn't let up, so then they had a DQ. Oh, okay, it's Tozawa. Yeah, okay, gotcha.
I kind of assumed he was talking about Tozawa, but...
The node mustache gentleman, and then the stupid gimmick. It's just one of those things, like, we're talking about so much, and then reading the comments, like, I just flowed from one thing. Anyway, it doesn't matter.
I gotcha.
You got me now. But the thing about this is they kept beating the crap out of him and they wouldn't let up, and was beating the crap out of Sami Zayn and Y2J. And I really, 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 really thought for sure we was going to get a Finn Balor appearance out of this. But lo and behold, no Finn Balor. I guess I'll wait another week.
I don't think we're going to get a Finn Balor.
Well, he's been showing up on all the live moves. Live shows.
He's been ready to go for like 8 months, and he's just like, oh, give me another week. I got some heartburn.
No, it's not him. They're protecting him.
I'm well aware.
You stop it. Just let me dream. Every time I want to dream, you come in like a bomber and just blow up my dreams.
You mean like I come in at number 30 spot?
Worse than that. But yeah, they didn't ever. I think a lot of people thought maybe that's why they didn't do it. Like everybody's expecting this, we'll just wait. But
they should have done it last week when they had the, or no, that was a fast lane when they had the guy that looked like dressed up as him sitting in the front row.
Just give him some turns and let him out there. how that all was going. Well, the thing is, they were going to have him come out the night after Fastlane, but for whatever reason, they were like, no, let's have Taker come out on Monday Night Raw instead and chokeslam Roman Reigns instead of just doing it at Fastlane, which would have been much better because...
Would have made the show better.
Braun would have won, probably.
Yep.
Anyway. So the next fun, exciting thing we had was, did you see New Day Talks?
No.
So because as you mentioned earlier, every wrestler has to have some kind of talk show. We had New Day Talks this week. It's going to be a brand new thing. And they're
So with the New Day, that makes sense. With Chris Jericho and The Miz, it makes sense. When it's like the Kevin Owens experience with a guy that has a cardboard thing taped to his head, it's only going to happen once. Let's not keep doing it.
Well, I think they even had Rollins Talks or something like that one time.
Yeah.
And I feel like somebody else over on SmackDown had one, but at least on SmackDown, they're like pretty much keeping it to The Miz.
Yeah.
They're not really doing it with anybody else. Anyway, so for the first great thing, they had The Big Show on. And what they would do, like, they brought him out and they asked him a question. He started answering. They're like, wait, we got to cut in real quick for a commercial thing for our sponsors. And I don't remember what their sponsor was, but Kofi just was, like, rambling on and on. So they go back to The Big Show and they ask him another question, and The Big Show kind of answers a little bit. And then they cut him off and then ask him another question. And it was basically all about the Robo-WrestleMania, that, like, Jetsons cartoon thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's what they were asking about. And so that whole thing was going on, and then poor Big Show. So then Titus O'Neil cuts in whistling, and he's like, hey, why wasn't I on this? The Titus brand needs to be on this. I needed to be in the Jetsons cartoon.
I wish we lived in an alternate reality where Titus O'Neil was actually relevant and not just used as some, like, hey, go job.
Well, I was thinking to myself, I have never... I lied. I've seen him win one time, and I have never seen him win other than that one time since we've watched. And the one time that he won was against... I don't remember who he had with him, but he beat Mark Henry, Goldust, and R-Truth. And a six-man tag match. That's the only time I've ever seen him win, and they won dirty, of course.
What a joke.
So anyway, Titus comes in, he starts running his mouth to the Big Show, basically is like, shut up, you're irrelevant. And the Big Show, of course, looks all pissed off. So they get a match out of this, because we needed it.
When?
Like, not that long afterwards.
Are you serious? So that's 7 matches on Raw?
Yeah.
Okay.
So what did we get? We got 1 choke slam. We got 2 choke slams. And then the crowd going, one more, one more. And by this time, he keeps grabbing Titus O'Neil's trunks, and they're, like, pulled all the way up his ass. He's wearing a thong at this point, so he gives him one more and just, like, ultra stretches up his ass and just choke slams him and then pins him.
An atomic wedgie plus.
It was unneeded. Who does this serve? Like, what does the Big Show get out of this? I guess he's preparing for his Andre the Match we don't care about. I don't know. I guess it's just getting him an in-ring shape, I guess, right?
I like this name that you've dubbed this match, Andre the Match We Don't Care About. That encompasses like a big chunk of the WrestleMania card.
Yeah.
Andre the Matches We Don't Care About.
Let's see. So did you see the tag team match for the number one contenders?
I did, but there was something before that.
Well, just go.
What? Nia versus Bayley.
Cover both of them. Go for it.
Okay. It was another week of making your champions look weak. Yes. And this week we threw in the added fun of let's disqualify every match.
Mm-hmm.
This ended in a DQ, and I don't even remember why.
Nia wouldn't get off of Bayley in the corner.
That's what
she had her in the Tree of Woe and just kept beating the crap out of her or something.
That's right. There's speculation that this is going to end up with a fatal four-way for the women's title because of what she said backstage with Stephanie, but who knows?
Yep.
And then the next match is actually Cesaro and Sheamus versus Cass and Enzo. Well, maybe not. I think it was the next match. It was the number one contenders thing. The whole time they have Gallows and Anderson standing backstage. I'm just going to call them the Bullet Club because that's where they're what they're known as.
No, they're the Good Brothers.
Are they? Is that what they're calling them? WWE?
That's what a lot of people have been calling them, the Good Brothers. Even the announcers call them that too.
It's such a stupid name, but it's funny, so we'll go with it. So the Good Brothers are backstage, and they're like watching a monitor, and like they're talking back and forth to each other like during this match, and the monitor is of the match that's going on. And so the match looked like Enzo every freaking match just takes a hell of a beating.
Yep.
And he sells it like amazingly too. Like you see some of the stuff that they do to him, and you're just like, man, I'd be dead. But they basically deliver a beatdown to him, or rather, Sheamus and Cesaro tag team match it up in typical Sheamus and Cesaro. We're gonna do double stomps. We're gonna do kicks off of kicks, and then. Cass gets in the match and like does a big boot to Sheamus and falls over the top rope, and here come the Good Brothers.
Doesn't it feel good? Doesn't it feel good to hear say that? The Good Brothers.
Yeah. So they come down, they come out of the crowd and jump over the barricade, and they hit Cesaro and Sheamus get hit first, but then they also hit. Well, actually, okay. So Sheamus gets hit by Anderson. Gallows hits Cass, and it's a disqualification. And this actually leads to them. It's going to be a triple threat for the tag team belts at Mania.
Because we need to have more of these. Smashed up, put as many people as you can into the ring matches, because now we have this three-way tag match. We have what'll probably be a four-way match for the women's belt. We're going to have the Andre the Match we don't care about. We're going to have the SmackDown, everybody and the women's roster in the match. We're going to have American Alpha. Well, okay, so that one's not. I feel like, the mixed tag match with John Cena and The Miz. Like, okay.
Too many cooks.
Too
many cooks.
So we just have Bray. Okay, we have, what, three? We'll probably have four one-on-one matches altogether.
AJ Shane,
Bray, and RKO, Goldberg and Lesnar, and then
KO and Jericho.
Okay, five. KO and Jericho, and then Neville and Austin Aries, which is a great segue into Austin Aries finally made his Raw appearance last night.
Nice.
And did you not see it?
Nope.
Well, you missed
out. Was it a match?
Yeah, it was a pretty decent match. She had Aria Daivari.
Okay, so there was eight matches last night.
Yep.
Just getting this counter up.
He faced Aria Daivari, or however you say his name, and Aries put on a clinic, naturally. I'm surprised that Daivari didn't get killed at the end, because I don't even know what the move's called, but Aries gave him some kind of slam over his back and dropped him, and he pretty much dropped him right on top of his head. And he was having trouble, like, getting back up to take his fall away elbow, or whatever you want to call it, the discus elbow. I don't know what he actually calls it, but he won, of course. So, and then last night on 205 Live, there was a 5-way match to see who the number one contender is. I didn't even watch it because I'm sure it was Austin Aries.
I saw Neville like doing a promo thing talking about there was going to be a fatal five way, and I was just like, can't there be something else? Like,
yeah,
we have fatal four way, can't we think of something else? But anyways,
I think they're just trying to get everybody involved and like cut ties as much as they can, I guess. I don't know. And then I guess at the same time, like, put all these people in these matches so they have their WrestleMania moment, as they keep saying over and over again.
Yeah, and it's really stupid, because I feel like what's happened is they decided, and I think I wish no ill harm upon him, but I feel like once Vince leaves, has nothing to do with it. I feel like it'll be better. I feel like there's too much of him at the last second saying no, and then we get left with garbage.
Roman Reigns.
I said garbage, yes.
Over and over again.
But, yeah.
So speaking of Roman Reigns, he had a match, which you can go ahead and talk about.
Oh.
I'm going to let you take this full-blown. Go right ahead.
Okay. Well, it was Hardbody Mahal, and...
That now you see where the Good Brothers feels better to say.
I don't know, man. Actually, okay, so we didn't really talk about the whole running thing throughout the night.
I was going to save that for last.
Okay, that's fine. That's actually how this match came about, so that's all I'll say about it.
Somebody is getting fired on Raw tonight. That was the overarching thing.
Yeah. So the match actually wasn't too bad. Again, Jinder Mahal shows promise.
No mention of Roman Reigns, just Jinder Mahal.
And then Roman Reigns does Roman Reigns things. And at one point, during the match, it's kind of close to the beginning, you get to hear dong, and it's the Undertaker's gong. And,
Roman gets nothing, all distracted.
Yeah, and that's what leads to Jinder Mahal like taking momentum of the match, and then they go to a commercial break, and they come back and confirm my worst nightmare, which is Roman Reigns versus Undertaker at WrestleMania. Serves no purpose match.
Well, they didn't say that just yet. You left out a big, huge part.
No, they said it before. Well, like, they went to the commercial break. Right, they said it, and then he was standing in the middle of the ring, because they said Undertaker is coming back for WrestleMania this year, and he's taking his the big dog is going to take his yard back, and then that's when, or maybe it was, I don't know, it happened before the big thing. Shawn Michaels comes out, and he's basically like, I wrote down that I'm chalking up the loss, like Undertaker loses. I have no reason to think otherwise now.
Well, Shawn Michaels comes out and basically is trying to warn Roman Reigns, like, hey,
if he's in your head already, he's going to really have a fun time with you at WrestleMania.
Yeah, like, don't underestimate him. Trust me, I know. And Roman Reigns basically kind of in a dick way was like, well... He retired you, so no offense. Now I'm going to retire him. And that's not really a face thing.
It's not, but I still don't feel like we get anything out of it. Because as soon as he turns heel, the next week, Vince will be like, we'll get him back out here. We got to have somebody to blah, 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 blah.
What a double twist.
Not double twist, like... I've just lost all hope for WrestleMania.
Just because of this?
Yes. Well, not because of this. Fastlane started it. And as Roman gets out of the ring to leave, we have a savior inbound, a giant bearded savior. And he plows over Roman, and Roman takes quite a tumble.
Probably one of the nastiest bumps I've seen all year.
He like legit like rolls all the way down the ramp and then falls off to the side. And like, I think we were talking about this before. It looks like Roman wasn't prepared, and he takes the hit and rolls down. Like Braun must have come in just a little bit early.
Yeah, I think so.
The wife and I were really excited. That was the pop of the night. Braun Strowman is like our household. We're gonna paint one of our walls to be Braun Strowman.
Why? You guys could just have a hairstyle like him.
I guess that's true. She would have to get the top part, and then I could have the beard.
There you go.
The rat tail.
Shave the sides of her head.
Yeah. And there's a part, like, right after he does this, right after he knocks the crap out of Roman Reigns, it's so funny, he looks at Shawn Michaels in the ring and he says, I would do this to you too if you got in my way. Just like, it's probably true.
Yeah. And Shawn the whole time looked so sad, like, when Roman was like, you suck, get out of my way.
Yeah, and he was like, I don't know, at one point during the whole thing, Shawn Michaels was like, I'm on your side, man. And I'm just like, this is it. This is the beginning of Clayton not watching wrestling anymore. Not really, but really being disappointed with wrestling. Let's put it that way.
Like, with WrestleMania coming up, like...
Don't give me this spiel.
What?
Because they have been building this garbage up, and then they threw everything away. And then they brought up, oh, well, Undertaker needs somebody to wrestle. Well, we'll just give him Roman Reigns, and Roman Reigns will beat him. And for whatever reason, this is either going to be, this will probably be the pinnacle. Like, it'll be the very last WrestleMania, because it'll be an even 25, right?
Mm-hmm.
And as far as I'm concerned, like, that's a good number to go out on. But why 23-2?
Well, I think one thing you're forgetting, because you're being so negative on it, is...
Can you blame me?
I still think that there is a big high chance that Braun Strowman will come out and screw over Roman Reigns and let Undertaker get the win.
I'm okay with that. If that happens. But
that's definitely an outcome that could happen.
But I have a feeling. I have this huge feeling... What are we, like 2 weeks away?
17 days, yeah.
Okay, so we've got two episodes of Raw left.
Mm-hmm.
What's going to happen is we're going to get an episode of Raw where Roman fights somebody, and then, or rather, he's going to fight Braun Strowman, and they're going to consider that tied up. Like, Braun's going to kick his butt or whatever, and they're going to consider that all tied up. Like, but then again, maybe not, because of the match the night after WrestleMania, or like 2 weeks or whatever after WrestleMania, it's Braun versus Roman.
Yeah.
Live. So I don't know. That's the best case scenario.
Yeah. No, what I was going to say is,
I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
Really, I think like that part could be a big negative for WrestleMania as a whole, but I still think there's going to be a lot of good matches for the most part. It's just we've been dogging this part so much. Because, I mean, you're going to have KO and Jericho. You're going to have Bray and Randy. AJ and Shane will be okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay with Lesnar versus Goldberg just because I still think that there's going to be a good chance that Braun will get the belt after that's all said and done and take out Brock. I still see that happening.
Well, I mean, that...
And you still have...
That doesn't make the match at WrestleMania good.
Like just
if we were still if we were still in a pay-per-view system and the pay-per-view was $60 and the highlight of the night was Brock Lesnar F5 Goldberg down.
But we don't know that that's if they go for 5-10 well, probably they're not going to go 10 minutes. We'll just say they go 5 minutes. I think it would be okay. But if they do a short match, that's stupid. I don't know. I just don't think that they will. I hope that they won't.
It'll be worse than WrestleMania 20 or whatever it was if they do.
I really don't think they will. Because they're already getting so much heat over it, and they know it.
Has that stopped Vince before? The only other time that I can think of would be Daniel Bryan.
But at WrestleMania?
Yeah, last year. Roman Reigns.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that was just like a last ditch effort to kind of get him over. Well, I don't want to say last ditch. Anyway, we got to move on from this. So the overarching thing of the night was Mick Foley basically had to fire somebody as a lesson from Stephanie McMahon because he's becoming better, coming around to his senses as a general manager, but he could use some improvements. So she wants him to pick one person from the Raw roster and fire them for during the night. And we kept getting segments of him like going over, like wondering what to do. A lot of superstars are on edge and talking about it, like, I don't want to get fired. I don't want to get fired. And you kept seeing Foley like, man, I don't know. And then there was even a segment where Stephanie's with him again. He's like, I'm really hoping I could talk you out of this. And she's like, you don't want to try to do that. You need to make a decision or else you're not going to like the outcome if I have to pick somebody.
Mm-hmm.
So basically at the end of the night, the last thing he has till the end of the night to do this, he comes out in the middle of the ring. Stephanie comes out with him also. They get out there and she's like, okay, so who is it? And he's like, I decided that for morale of backstage and for the fans as a whole, the person that needs to go is you, Stephanie. And she's basically like, I'm over you, Mick. You can't fire me. And he's like, yeah, but you still need to go. You're what's wrong with Raw.
It was pretty great.
It was. And she was kept running her mouth to him. And Triple H came out. And it was like, Foley, you're washed up and old. Look at you hobbling around. And Foley kind of talks some trash back to Triple H. And the best part of that whole thing was Foley whipped out Socko and gave the mandible claw to Triple H in the corner.
Yep. And it was total, like, it was one of those things where, like, you could tell he was going to do it.
Yep.
But you weren't expecting it, really?
I didn't expect it. Like, I didn't see that coming.
I thought he was going to leave, and then he stops in the corner, and I see his, like, he pulls his shirt up a little bit, and I was like, oh. And it, like, he just stood there for a second, and then that happens, and I actually jumped out of the couch, like, up off the couch, and was like, yes! And Molly's like,
it's a sock.
I don't understand. Yeah, it's a sock.
Yeah, so he gives you the mandible claw, and Triple H is getting ready to beat the crap out of Mick Foley, and then cue Mr. Seth Rollins. Seth freaking Rollins. Music comes out. He has his crutch with his brand new shirt that says King Slayer on it.
Yep.
Let me just throw my wallet at the screen. He gets down to the ringside. He picks his crutch up and just drops it on the floor. And everybody's like, oh, yes. He gets in there and starts beating the shit out of Triple H. 10 out of 10. Triple H gets the upper hand and starts beating the shit out of Seth Rollins.
With the crutch.
With the crutch. The crutch is like completely bent. Looks like a question mark when he's done with it. Gets him. He got him like a figure four. Was it a figure four he got him in?
Yeah, it was a figure four, but it was like the reverse thing.
Oh, yeah. That's what it was. And so, yeah. Then, of course, it looked like Seth Rollins was in pain. But that all tied in. That was like a really good story arc overall. Like, they did the exact same thing on SmackDown with AJ, but not the exact same thing, but like the overarching story thing going all night long.
Yeah.
So I'm playing Warframe while listening, and I thought I heard you say Seth Rollins is your crush, Rick. He's not my crush, but...
Pretty much is what he said, yeah.
No.
This particular, like, match is a crush for you.
Well, yeah. I just think
I understand it, like...
I think it's awesome.
If it happens, it'll be... I think it's pretty much slated and in the books, or else he wouldn't have come out.
Well, from what I understood, he can do light duty, but they still... People, the doctors and stuff, don't want him to do, like, a full match yet. So, a few bumps here and there, it's okay, but...
Every freaking thing that he did was with that leg.
Yep.
I don't know if you noticed it. Like, he kicked Triple H in the stomach, and...
I think it was just like, let's test this thing out.
Yeah.
See how good it is.
Yeah.
I want it to be. That's another one of those matches I was saying. Like, there's some decent matches in there, really, for WrestleMania. If it all works out fine.
There are, but there's a huge amount of stinkers, too. Mm-hmm. They have potential, but, like, it's stuff we've seen over and over. Or it's stuff that they don't seem like they have any clue what they're doing.
Well, these matches with, like, everybody in them, it's just one of those things that just depends on what they do with it.
Yeah.
If it's okay, so with the Good Brothers, Sheamus and Cesaro, Enzo and Cass, you know those three teams are going to put on a really good match.
Yeah.
But it's just the fact, like, a lot of people, me included, I don't like having all these. So, and where you have the women's on SmackDown and Raw, basically everybody that is on the rosters in those matches in some way, however they're going to do it, it's kind of like, that's just a recipe for disaster. That's like Royal Rumbles and stuff like that. It's just a big botch of a match. So many things can go wrong because there's so many moving parts in it.
Well, I think the Andre the Match we don't care about, from what I understand, Braun might be in that.
Ugh, come on. He needs to do something, so I guess it makes sense. And if he is, I mean, he'll win.
He better win.
Yeah.
Like, and he better come out and interfere in the Undertaker match. But
he will. Just tell yourself that he will.
I'm going to trust you on this matter, and consider trust forever broken. You better keep Steam chat open.
It will be. Close right afterwards, probably.
Yeah, I'll have to find that delete button, delete friend button.
Delete and unfollow.
Yeah.
So, overall for Raw as a whole, I'm probably going to get it a 7.5. Like, there was definitely some filler because every single week you get filler, but they did a very good job of moving everything forward as far as story they needed to WrestleMania. There was some decent matches in there. Also, the CM Punk chants need to stop at, like, crucial parts of the night. It's kind of annoying,
like,
at this point.
Yeah, like, during the Triple H, like, when he was yelling at Mick.
Yeah. Stupid.
CM Punk. I get, like, they want him to come back, but he didn't really leave on the best of terms.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think he's coming back.
And they still have that lawsuit going on, so... Yeah, he's not coming back anytime soon.
Also, the Mick Foley thing kind of sets up for what we have been talking about.
Mick Foley being on his way out. Yep. And I think it's...
You suck.
This path is a good path to take, though. They are doing a good job of handling it this way.
Yep. And the Seth Rollins thing is going really well, and I would say that the reason it's going really well is because somebody other than Vince has control over that.
And his name is Triple H.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's gonna be one of the better things at WrestleMania. If it indeed does end up happening, and I'm positive at this point that it will, because when he dropped the crutch, I was like,
yeah,
we have a new John Cena here.
So yeah, that. So what'd you give Raw? 7.5.
Same thing. Yeah, it was just SmackDown felt lacking, and as many disqualifications and stuff as there was, at least everything on Raw built towards
something
more. Yeah.
I agree. All right. Well, do you have anything else to add?
No, sir.
Well, that will be it for us tonight as far as the WWE Week in Review goes. I'm going to stop the stream here in just a few minutes to take a quick 5-minute break, but then we'll pick right back up with some Jackbox Party 3. Jack Party, whatever it's called. But yeah, thanks again, Clay Monster, for assisting me in this show. I appreciate it.
No problem, man. Anytime.
Thanks, everybody, for dropping in. Lemon, I look forward to playing with you soon. And, yeah. So have a good night, everybody, and we will see you later.
Peace out.